You are listening to Packers Talk Radio Network.
Packers Talk.
Eddie Lacy, Mike Daniels, Gilbert Brown, Don Barclay, Micah Hyde, your Green Bay Packers, yesterday's legends and today's superstars. From corporate or nonprofit events to private parties, add some spice, hire a Packers player from Mayfield Sports Marketing. For details, just go to PackersTalk.com and click on Player Appearances.
Are you looking for some signed Packer memorabilia?
Look no further than Waukesha Sports Cards.
If a Green Bay Packer can sign it, Waukesha Sports Cards has it.
Check our website for upcoming Packer player and legend signings.
Go to WaukeshaSportsCards.com.
This is Titletown Sound.
Prepare yourself for overwhelming intelligence.
He's going to look like Gronk riding a unicorn carrying a lightsaber.
I know how toast works.
Clay Matthews, squirrel whisperer.
Your squirrel-naming game is not strong.
The third cheeseburger could come back.
If one of us wants to pee on it, sure.
I'm not bailing you out on that.
I was acting unprofessionally.
I'm just here to ruin things.
Welcome, everyone, to episode 68 of Titletown Sound, the Mike Wall edition of the podcast. We're finally here in the postseason. We can all relax a little bit. Feels good, doesn't it? Feels good to have the weight of the football season off our shoulders at last.
Yeah, because there's so much pressure on us.
Oh, yeah. Hey, we got to pump out a podcast every single week. And it takes days to prepare our podcast in the regular season. And here, you know, it only took two. But, yes, here this week is a man who watched the Super Bowl, Chris Christofko. Chris, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well. I am.
Also joining us this week is a man who watched the Super Bowl strictly for the commercials, James Corsmo. James, how you doing?
Oh, I'm fantastic.
Excellent.
Monkey baby all day long.
I mercifully missed that commercial somehow. I, of course, am Dave Bopke, also known as Bobo, and I swear, honey, I was just watching the Super Bowl for the articles, and that's it. On today's podcast, we talk about the Packers hitting free agency, we answer a few of your Twitter questions, and we discover a way to play Twister over the internet, so you'll want to stick around for that. But first, let's talk about the game that was the Super Bowl, which the Packers weren't in, but that's okay.
You really had to mention that, huh?
Well, you know, I wanted to make sure everybody remembered, but the Packers did play both teams in the Super Bowl in back-to-back weeks, interestingly enough.
How'd that go?
Let's talk about that, please.
Yeah, I wasn't going to talk about how those two games went, but how everything kind of went south from there. But Chris, I'll throw to you here. Carolina and Denver both terrific teams, very good defenses, but how do I put it? They're not the 85 Bears, I guess. That's kind of what I want to introduce that with.
The Broncos defense is fantastic. 85 Bears, I don't know, but they're pretty incredible. But I think what the Super Bowl taught me, or not that I really learned anything, but what the Super Bowl kind of brought home for me was that every single team in the NFL is flawed. Every team. The Super Bowl winner, no matter who they are, they're usually a somewhat flawed team. And the reason is because with the salary cap the way it is, the league is built for parity, and it's built so you cannot be a perfect team. The reason I bring this up is because there's been so much talk about the window closing and, you know, you got to get it done for Aaron Rodgers now, blah, 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 blah. Ted's got to go crazy in free agency. He's got to, you know, sign this guy, that guy, bring Calvin Johnson out of retirement. And it's not necessarily true. Should Ted be a little bit more aggressive in free agency? Yeah, because he pretty much doesn't sign anyone now. But to say he's got to be radically different is to say that he's got to do something that really doesn't make sense the way he's built the team, because right now this team is a very strong defensive team, believe it or not. With the way they played this year, they've defense, or at least a very good defense, and they've got a number one receiver coming back. That the way they're built, they're built better than almost any other team in the league, and they have the opportunity to add a piece or two, but they don't have to go crazy. So my point is, the Packers will always be flawed. Almost every team is, without exception, flawed in some way. And both of those Super Bowl teams were flawed. So I wonder why all of a sudden there's this call for, you know, we got to do something because we're wasting Rodgers years away. I just don't buy that.
James, any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, the Broncos defense is one of the best we've seen in a long time, but there are flaws all over that team. It's, you know, and if you go back and you look, last year the Patriots, you know, they were held together by duct tape, baling wire, and, you know, Tom Brady's UGG boot fur. That's all they had. The year before that, the Seahawks, you know, they great defense again, sputtering offense. You don't necessarily have to have a team that's lights out and, you know, 99 ranking on Madden in all three phases of the game. You just got to have a team that is really, really good in one or two areas and can manage otherwise. And I think this year the Broncos were the best in the league at that, especially with Peyton Manning back there playing duck hunt.
And can we talk about Brock Osweiler, who is going to be completely forgotten this season, but is the reason they were in the Super Bowl?
Yes. Without Osweiler, they're not there. They're just not. And he gets no credit at all, at all. And I've seen articles all over the place saying he's going to be on, you know, a different team next year because he's a free agent. And they're not, you know, I don't know. But they were lucky to have him this year. I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, certainly having somebody to fill in for Peyton Manning at some point was, I don't want to say a foregone conclusion, but yeah, that kid out of Arizona State did well enough when they needed him to. And I guess to kind of go back toward the point we originally brought up about how flawed teams are, I guess it's that idea that you don't necessarily need to be the best team in the league the whole season. You simply need to be peaking at the right time.
And I think with the salary cap structured the way it is right now, it's going to be rare that you're going to see a wire-to-wire team that's going to be, I mean, Carolina was about as close as you can get. And you could say, I mean, look at their receiving core. I mean, who are we getting excited about there? You know, Ted Ginn? You know, it's a flawed team. So, you know, I do think it's going to be more rare to see that wire-to-wire winner because of just the way the league is structured. And it's a good structure because it creates parity, and that's what you want for, you know, competitiveness. And
unless you're in Cleveland.
Yeah, this is true.
I don't know. How did we start picking on the Cleveland Browns every week?
They kind of started picking on themselves.
That's
you know,
true.
Really our fault.
Well, anyways, as I contemplate the Cleveland Browns' existence here, we also wanted to talk a little bit about John Elway, as he has sort of been dubbed the anti-Ted Thompson, going out, getting free agents, and kind of helping to build the team up in that way. I guess, James, what are your thoughts as far as the way John Elway builds a team versus the way Ted Thompson builds teams?
Well, full disclosure, I loathe John Elway and everything he stands for and the air that he breathes and his big horse teeth and everything else. I cannot stand the man. I'm bitter. I'm a bitter, angry Packers fan.
Wow.
But anyway, yeah, that's how I feel. Sorry. Sorry, not sorry, hashtag. But John Elway hit on a lottery this year, specifically last offseason when he went out and he got Gary Kubiak to come in and manage an aging quarterback who didn't play his game anymore. He couldn't be Peyton Manning of old. He couldn't be the guy throwing the ball 60 times down the field to Marvin Harrison because he just didn't have the arm anymore. He's just not healthy. He found a coach that wasn't afraid to bench Peyton Manning in the third quarter of a game against Kansas City where he had thrown four picks and just looked god-awful. And, you know, then Osweiler came in, and for the next couple weeks, he saved their season. To me, the Gary Kubiak signing or hiring it was the catalyst for the whole season, honestly. John Fox wouldn't have won the Super Bowl this year with that team. He just wouldn't have. And then obviously going out and getting DeMarcus Ware and, you know, Von Miller and Aqib Talib, who, even though he played like hot garbage on during the Super Bowl, was a big piece of the puzzle to get there. So I have to say that in the bingo game that is the NFL season, he was able to get all of his spots filled. And whether or not they stay there, who knows? But kudos to him, because, you know, that's something that it's difficult to do, especially when in, you know, the John Elway, and you're not very bright.
And did you mention he looks like a horse?
He has a horse face. He is a horse face man.
He did play for the Broncos, so.
Which is perfect. There's a reason that he did not want to play for who was it? Who drafted him? The Colts who drafted him.
I think it was the Colts. Yeah.
See, that would have worked too, though.
But a Bronco is more manly. It's a manlier horse.
So, talk about John Elway versus Ted Thompson, because I've seen a lot of comments that Ted Thompson needs to be more like John Elway. I think you raise a good point that you have to hit on your free agents. And that's so if you miss on a draft pick, it's a kind of a recoverable loss. Because you could be like Ted Thompson. Maybe you miss on a second rounder, but you knock it out of the park in the fifth and sixth rounds, and that makes up for it. And plus, you're not tied to a long-term deal with that guy for a lot of money when you miss. When you miss with a free agent, you can leave a huge hole on your roster and eat up a lot of cap space. And I think the Broncos are in, you know, a little bit of cap. You know, they're not in the best cap position right now. The Packers are in very good position. So I don't think that Ted Thompson needs to be more like John Elway. I think that maybe Ted Thompson needs to be slightly less like Ted Thompson and consider a piece or two more than just James Jones when it comes to the free agent market, because there were some obvious glaring needs and some obvious, and I don't want to say solutions, but at least there were some options out there that wouldn't have broken the bank and would have been kind of nice ads that Thompson kind of ignored. So I think Ted Thompson needs to do a little bit more, but the John Elway is like the roulette of GMing. You got to get so lucky, and then even then you're not building for the long term, because when you're drafting and developing, you get these guys for, you know, 3-4 years for almost nothing. You get them for a free contract, and then you try to re-sign them and, you know, get them before they go into free agency. You might be able to get them a little cheaper than if they went on the market. So you're able to get like three to six years out of these guys before you have to spend a fortune. And that's really a key in the cap era. John Elway was all in because he knew Peyton Manning had a rag for an arm or you know, wasn't going to last much longer. I really think that he wanted to try to put something together for this year, and that's great. But Aaron Rodgers isn't at that point yet.
All right. Fair. Oh, anything else to add, James?
Absolutely not. I think he hit the nail on the head there. I say a lot of mean things about John Elway, and I mean them all. But he did a really good job this year, and I hope that it never happens again.
All right. So hashtag bash Elway. We'll get that going on Twitter. Maybe come back to that later in the show. Speaking of quarterbacks, Cam Newton, been in the news quite a bit since the Super Bowl loss. I in particular admit that I enjoyed the Andy Griffith clip with Cam's head put on OB's face and talking about losing and how that sucks. But Chris, I guess I'll throw it to you. Cam Newton, what have we learned? What do we still have to learn about the complex man that is Cam Newton?
We've learned that Cam Newton is his own worst enemy. I, frankly, find his on-field celebrations fun and harmless, and I don't care. And it's the kind of guy that if he was celebrating like that and he was on my team, I would be high-fiving myself and, you know, pouring beers over my head, and it would be awesome. But if you're going to be that flamboyant in victory and that, you know, outspoken, you've got to be able to take defeat better than he did. And so let's go fast forward past the game to the press conference when he, first of all, is giving one-word answers. Second of all is you know, stomping off after a very brief amount of time. Whether or not you could hear the Broncos players in the background or not, I don't care. He's got to put on a show there. He's got to be gracious in defeat. I know he's miserable. I guarantee you all of those guys, when they lose, are miserable because they're competitors. But then that's the excuse I heard. Well, he just wants to win so bad. There's a lot of guys that want to win so bad, but they can kind of pull it together. Now, look, other people have done this too. I know Peyton Manning himself kind of walked off without shaking hands and a playoff loss, and Tom Brady's done it. But when you're this flamboyant in your wins, you got to be prepared to take the criticism when you're not a good loser. And I think he learned that. I hope he can kind of, I don't know. I like Cam Newton. I don't know why, but I think he's fun to watch. I was disappointed to see how he reacted.
Fair point. James, your thoughts?
I also enjoy watching Cam Newton. I'm not as big of a fan of the you score a touchdown, I get it. Do the dab, give the ball to a kid, which I honestly think is awesome that he does that. I really love that. Okay, and then just go, then go back to the bench. You don't need to be doing 10 minutes of choreographed Shapoopy, stuff, and then taking team photos with 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter. It's not, to me, it just seems unnecessary. But that being said, I enjoy watching him play. Now, with the Super Bowl, the after the game stuff was stupid. He should have taken his lumps like anybody else. What bothered me more was his on the field stuff, specifically the play everybody's talked about. You have the MVP of the league in the biggest game of the year, and the ball's at his feet after it's stripped from his hand, and he takes two steps back from it. To me, that right there is inexcusable. I don't care. It's the fourth quarter of the Super Bowl. You're down by 7 points. The ball's on the ground. You got to get it. You got to go down there and get it. And if you're hurt, you're hurt, but at least you went out trying. Because now you just look like a petulant, mean prima donna guy as opposed to a player. That's just how I feel. That bothered me a lot more than the after the game stuff.
I agree with you there. When I saw that clip, I couldn't believe it, because he's not the kind of guy that usually. I mean, he puts his body on the line all the time, more so I think than he should as a quarterback. And that really, I don't get that. I don't know why, but in that moment, for whatever reason. And that moment is going to haunt him. I mean, for years, that's going to haunt him. I wish I could get inside his head and know what was going on. I'd love, why is he not diving on that ball? He's literally throwing himself at huge linemen all the time. And in that case, he decides not to dive for a ball. In possibly the biggest moment, on the biggest stage, I was shocked.
I have to say, it struck me when I watched that play live and I saw him not going for the ball. Part of me thought, well, two other guys are kind of there in on the play already and he doesn't want to get in on that. But part of it seemed to me like this is a guy that it's sort of like playing football, like, after school or playing football in your backyard with your friends. And you hit a point where your team's just not doing that well and you're not having fun anymore. And you've kind of given up. Like, there's a play and you just, something kind of doesn't go that well and you don't make nearly the effort that you would if you were having fun or if you were winning. I don't know. That's what it seemed like to me. Is it just a guy who was kind of dejected, and I don't know if giving up is too extreme a phrase, but he didn't look like he was trying.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean. And I don't know how we can compare, non-professional sports, but I know what you mean. Maybe that's it. They weren't in it. It was an odd situation, but I was shocked because with the way he plays, you would think his instinct would be to dive on that ball, that he wouldn't even, but again, that is going to haunt him until he wins a Super Bowl. That will haunt him for as long as it takes.
Yep, that could have been the game right there. If you'd have jumped on that ball, who knows what happens,
Well, I say, I still don't have a whole lot of confidence in them driving against Denver, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at that point. Right. No one will remember that they had to face that Denver defense, people will see that clip hundreds of more times. You know, it'll be played before the first game that the Panthers play next year. It'll be played when Denver and Carolina face off in the regular season, which they will next year. You know, it will be played over and over again. And there's no, it doesn't matter the circumstance. All that matters is it was a Super Bowl and he didn't do it.
Well, speaking of things that need to be done, we have a promo to do here. So let's talk about our sponsor at this point. Titletown Sound is brought to you by the Law Office of Christopher Schultz. Christopher specializes in traffic and municipal violations, wills, and estate planning. If you're in need of help, Chris has your back. Call 920-252-0692. Number again, 920-252-0692. And if Jeremy were here, he would be gushing about his experience with Christopher. And
well, let me say, because for some people do know, some people don't. I practiced law for about 6 years before I changed careers. And the one praise that Jeremy gives Chris is that he returned his calls and he spoke to him and he walked him through the process. I can tell you from experience that not every attorney does that. So if you're looking for somebody, whether it's a simple situation you need to handle, those are sometimes the most difficult because your lawyer won't call you back, won't explain what's going on. If Chris is doing that for Jeremy, it's somebody that I would give a call if I needed help.
Yeah, especially because it's Jeremy. I mean, who wants to talk to him?
That's a good point. That's like a higher degree of difficulty there.
Yeah, what a hose bag. Anyway, let's see. Time for Twitter questions here. As I scroll down on my little Microsoft Word document. We asked you for some Twitter questions a little bit ago, and we've got three of them here. And I'm going to start with this one from Cody Bauer at C Bauer NFL Draft. Why is it perceived that the Packers need help at wide receiver? The number one wide receiver is coming back, and so is last year's third pick. And James, I'll throw that one to you first. Seems like Cody's making a pretty fair point here with I don't want to say the plethora of receivers, but I mean, when we got down to bare bones, we still had some pretty good receivers, right?
Right. I mean, absolutely. Absolutely. I've noticed over the last couple of days, I've seen on Twitter and other places, people clamoring for a first round wide receiver pick or a second. And it kind of boggles my mind too. The only thing that I can really think of is that for the most of this season, everything after week six, our wide receiving core, to put it in the most positive of terms, was not great. And I think that people have forgotten what an impact Jordy Nelson makes on a team, and a healthy Ty Montgomery and, you know, Devontae Adams, whatever was going on with him, if he can get right. In my personal opinion, we need, and by we I mean the Packers, I'm not actually affiliated with the team, but they're my team. The Packers need many more other things than wide receivers. They need a tight end who can catch the ball and then move a foot or two before he falls down. They need some linebackers that can cover running backs out of the backfield. They need bigger pieces than wide receiving at this point. So I think Cody makes a good point. I can't argue with him, even though I want to.
I agree too. I don't think that wide receiver is a real concern. So you've got Nelson, Cobb, Montgomery returning. James Jones, I would guess, is not. He's very slow and very old. And hoodie or not, I just don't think he comes back. You've got Aberderis. You got Jeff Janis for what, you know, for your all of your Hail Mary needs. You've got Devontae Adams, you know, we don't know where he is. So there might be a little bit of a depth issue there that they might want to fill in some of the mid to late rounds, but I don't see it being a high priority. I really don't. And I wouldn't be surprised to see them fill in some talent, you know, in the fifth or sixth round. And Thompson can find guys out there that'll be productive, but I don't see a high pick used on a wide receiver, but which means, you know, Ted Thompson will take with the first round pick some wide receiver I've never heard of before.
To say, and I still remember when the Packers drafted Jordy Nelson, I thought the last thing the Packers need right now is a wide receiver, but well, worked out pretty well in the end.
Not bad.
Also, I not to change topics over to professional wrestling here, but I feel like every time we mention Jeff Janis, we should have Triple H's King of Kings theme played. Jeremy, that's something maybe we can work on, but you know, James knows what I'm talking about.
I think it'd be great.
It'd be perfect. Anyways, yes, our next tweet comes from @RossUglum. We just wanted to kind of mention this one. Who of the Packers 2017 free agents are you most excited about leaving town if Thompson is aggressive in free agency? We just like that tweet.
That's pretty much the perfect tweet. I think you got every topic in. So yeah, I mean, I don't know that we can, that's a tough one to answer, but it's brilliant.
There is no answer to that tweet other than that is the perfect tweet. It doesn't get any better than that. You fit every single trope into one 140 character thing. It's amazing.
I mean, if you had 160 characters, he could have added a fire capers in there. That's the only way you might have improved.
Oh, that's a good point. Get on it, Twitter.
Yeah. We may have to downgrade the grade from A+ to A- without the fire capers, but still pretty solid. All right, we've got one from @RustyWeese. Which is more likely, Ted trading up to take a top inside linebacker like Jalen Smith or signing a top free agent tight end like Ladarius Green? Chris, what's more likely, trading up for top linebacker or signing a top free agent tight end?
Winning Powerball is more likely than both of those things. I mean, Thompson just doesn't value inside linebackers. And I don't know that this year is going to change that much. I know that McCarthy wants Clay Matthews on the outside exclusively. I don't know that Ted is going to answer that request necessarily by drafting an inside linebacker early. And I don't think he's going to go after, a premium tight end in the draft. I mean, in free agency either. I just think both of those things are kind of the exact opposite of the way that Thompson operates. And because of that, I really don't, and this is a cop-out, I don't think either of them is going to happen. I don't think either of them is likely, and so I will pick neither.
Bold. I like that. However, gun to head, I think Thompson would draft before he'd sign a free agent. That's my answer.
You know, I think you're right. I just don't think he's going to do it.
I don't think he will either, but who knows? Who knows? Maybe this is the year that Ted finally, I don't know,
oh no, we're into the this is the year portion of the year. No, we all get there. It happens, every one of us, at some point in the off season we all say, maybe this is the year that Ted ... I do it, you do it, we all do it, and sure, yet it's never the year. It's never the year.
Eternal hope.
But we will get that. We will do it again this year. Even after this conversation, at some point, I will think to myself, maybe this is the year that Ted, and then he won't.
All right. I'm still debating what my thought is on that. I would love to see Ladarius Green wearing green and gold, but screw it. I'll go tight end. Why not? Because, it's... I don't know. It usually gets those seemingly inconsequential pieces. And if it's not Antonio Gates, I mean, Ladarius Green's kind of the lesser known name. So maybe everybody else will forget about him somehow. And
maybe, yeah.
Yeah, I'll just keep going with that idea. So on that note, let's talk about more free agents. This time, the Packers own free agents. We're going to run through some of the names here. And Chris and James, you guys get to kind of discuss each player briefly as to whether you think they will be back or if they should be back or if you just want them to go away and put #fire and then their last name. The choice is yours. So let's start at quarterback Scott Tolzien. And Chris, do you think he will be back or should be back?
I don't think he'll be back because I think they like Hundley, and I don't see them re-signing Tolzien and having Hundley on the roster. They may bring in another third quarterback, but I think that what Hundley showed them may be enough that Tolzien's out of there. But I'm probably wrong. I would like to see him back because I think he provides a lot of stability in that quarterback position. I think he's ready to be a solid backup. I don't know that he's going to get a chance to start anywhere, but I'd like to see him. Don't think we will.
James, your thoughts?
I agree wholeheartedly. I would love to see Scott Tolzien back forever until he retires. I think he's kind of a rock. He's there for Aaron when Aaron needs him. He's kind of like Doug Peterson was to Brett Favre. He's just there. Will he be back? If I were a betting man, I would say no. I don't think he'll be back. I think somebody's going to give him a paycheck that's more than we should give him, and he'll be gone. And more power to him. I hope he has a great career wherever he goes. Nothing but love for the Tolzien.
Mm-hmm. I literally thought Doug Peterson, and within 1 second you said his name. So I'm just, yes. Next name on the list here is James Starks. James, you get this one first.
I'm of two minds on James Starks. I love the guy when he holds on to the ball and when he figures out some wily coyote way to lose it and the worst possible time, I want to ship him on the first train to Siberia. I think he'll be back. I personally think they'll re-sign him. That's just Ted's MO, keep a veteran running back around. And I'm okay with it, I guess. I just wanted to hold on to the ball more. He killed us a couple times this year.
I mean, the thing is, you're not going to have to sign him early in free agency. He's going to be on the street for quite some time. So I agree with you that I think they bring him back real cheap. And I don't mind having some veteran running back presence with Fat Eddie and his questionable return next year. P90X or whatever the hell he's doing. I don't know, you know, whether or not that works, we'll see. But I don't mind having James Starks back. He is frustrating with his fumbles, but, you know, thankfully he was there because Eddie wasn't for a good part of the year.
Yeah, when he's on, he's on. He could be a starter for, you know, most of the league when he's on. It's just hold on to the ball, Neil.
But he's also north of 30, and, you know, it's just not going to happen.
Oh, true.
Speaking of north of 30, next name on the list is John Kuhn. And if Jeremy were here, we know what he would say. But Chris, you get this one first.
At the beginning of the year, I would have said it's definitely the end of the line for John Kuhn. But they carried two fullbacks this year, and it didn't seem to hurt them. So will they do it again? Maybe. If I were a betting man, I would say he's not back, though.
James, agree, disagree?
Well, from everything I've seen with Kuhn in regards to his relationship with the Packers, I'm starting to think that if Kuhn wants to be back with the Packers, he'll be back with the Packers. It's just up to him to tell Ted, hey, I want to come back. For some reason, he's kind of just there. And I'm okay with it. You know, he's a veteran leader. The guys all seem to look up to him and, you know, he says all the right things and he does all the right things and he's always where he's supposed to be. He's getting up there and, you know, we have the Ripper waiting to back him up who, you know, could be better than Kuhn.
Could be.
I'm sorry. Sorry, Jeremy. Sorry, Jeremy, wherever you are. He's Kuhn. He's Kuhn on a magical comet filled with Skittles and love.
All right.
Yes. But I don't know. It's up to Kuhn, I think. That's my answer, and I'm sticking to it.
I'm presuming that wasn't intended to be any kind of reference to Marshawn Lynch by the Skittles thing. But
I could have picked a better candy. I'm sorry. That's bad.
Okay. That's all right. We put the pressure on you. How about Swedish Fish? That work?
Underrated.
Not a fan. Yeah. Not a fan.
Interesting. I'm more of a Mamba guy myself. That's, you know, that doesn't sound untrue. But anyways, topic for another show. Next is tight end Andrew Corliss. James, do you think he will be back, should be back, or will not be back?
He gone. See ya, Andrew.
Yeah, later.
See ya. You can go find a potted plant somewhere else and hide behind it because that's all you're good for at this point.
Yeah, I don't think we have to spend a whole lot of time. He's done.
Yeah.
All right. Hashtag bye, Felicia.
What accent was that? It was like Kentucky and Wisconsin combined.
I think that I was going for Chris Tucker there. I'm not entirely sure.
It was terrible.
Oh, gosh. All right, Don Barclay, save me. Will he be back or should he be back, Chris?
I love Don Barclay.
Yes, you do.
I met the man. He was so nice to me. He's awesome. I don't think they gave him a fair shake. I think Don Barclay is a backup guard. But they don't think that. They tried to play him a tackle. It didn't go well. I don't think he's back. I think they try to find some talent in the draft, but I don't think Barclay returns.
I am very glad that he was nice to you when he met you, and he seems like a very pleasant man. He does. All the interviews I've seen with him, he seems very nice. That being said, and I know a lot of it's not his fault. He's not a tackle. He's just not, and he's not anywhere on the left side. Don't put him there. That's bad. But he can leave, and I will not be unhappy. I think my writing this year speaks for itself with Barclay. I got to the point with him where I was beyond frustrated. So
yeah,
I won't be sad to see him leave. I do wish him success. I hope he catches on somewhere and plays well, just not here.
All right, switching over to the defensive side of the football, Casey Hayward. James, what do you think about him?
This is the one guy that I wish we could keep, but I'm pretty sure we won't. I love Casey Hayward, specifically as a slot corner. On the outside, he's not that great, but he's one of the better slot corners in the league. And we don't need him necessarily anymore as much as we did now that we have Quentin Rollins and Demarius Randall and Gunter, which is fun to say. But I love Casey Hayward, and I sure would like to have him back, but it's not going to happen.
Casey, I agree with you on that sentiment. He's the one that I wish we could have back, but someone's going to overpay him. They're going to overpay him because he had a good year. I mean, he had quietly had a good year this year, and he got lost in the shuffle because of the rookies. They were so solid. But, yeah, he'd be nice to have back. I don't think they can afford him, and that's unfortunate because he'd be a real nice luxury to have.
Yes. He's going to be the Devon House of this year's offseason where somebody's going to give him a contract that's just silly.
I miss Devon House. But anyway, sticking sort of with the secondary, I know this guy was kind of getting moved a little bit. Sean Richardson. Chris, will he be back? Should he be back? Won't he be back?
He's not going to be back, right? Injury. He's got – didn't he – he hurt his neck again, right?
That could be.
Yeah, I believe it was the Nick Collins injury.
Yeah, I don't. There's no way they're bringing him back, and that was his second neck injury. So unfortunately he's done.
That's sad. Next on my list here is Nick Perry, and James, you get this one.
Oh, I love Nick Perry. If you'd asked me at the beginning of this past season my thoughts on Nick Perry, it would have been see ya. You can go. And now after this year where he stayed healthy for the majority of it, which is some sort of minor miracle in and of itself, and he played so well when he was healthy, I would love to keep him. He's one of those – I'm on the fence with him. I don't know if he'll come back or not. I really don't. I know that's a cop-out, but I don't know. I don't know if we're going to pay for him.
I hope that other teams see him as injury-prone as we do, because then maybe you get to bring him back cheap or a little bit cheaper. I would like to bring Nick Perry back when he's been healthy. And that's a big when. That's like when I've been skinny. But when he's been healthy, he's been very effective. And this year it was like he kind of figured it out. And he was a great part of this defense. And they don't have a whole lot of guys on the line that can get to the quarterback like that. So I wish we could bring him back. I don't know that we'll be able to, because anyone with any ability to get to the pass rusher or get to the quarterback seems to get overpaid. So that may very well happen.
Mm-hmm. All right. Another outside linebacker, Mike Neal. Chris, your thoughts?
I have like a love-hate relationship with Mike Neal. If the play is coming right at him, Mike Neal is a solid defender. If, however, the play is not coming right at him and is going somewhere else, he's really good at overcommitting to where he thinks the play was going. But he has flashes and he plays, he's kind of solid at times. I don't think they're going to miss much if he's gone, though. But I don't know what the Packers are going to do. If I had to guess, I would say he's not coming back. But that is almost purely a guess.
Yeah, I don't think he's back. I think that they're gonna give money to other guys. I think he's gonna be gone, and that's okay. I like him too, but like you said, he has his moments where you wonder where he went. So
yeah.
All right. Another linebacker. This, James, you get to go first on the pride and joy of the Canadian Football League, Andy Malumba.
Andy Malumba. Sorry, that's a Full House reference. He's another one. He can't stay healthy. At least this year, you know, he was out for most of the year. And honestly, when he's healthy, he's never been lights out. The only reason I could see keeping him around is because we're so weak at inside linebacker and they want to move Clay outside so bad. But other than that, you know, if Ted can figure out a cheap deal for him, then possibly. But other than that, he can go.
Yeah, I don't have much to add. You guys are going to be shocked, but I don't have an Andy Mumba hot take. But yeah, he's just kind of a guy. But with their weakness at inside linebacker, I could see it.
All right. Just as a quick side note to all presidential candidates, if any of you can promise me that Full House will never be referenced on this podcast ever again, I will be more than happy to vote for you.
This is the man who once made like 12 Avril Lavigne references in one podcast. So I don't think you have much room to talk.
Yeah.
Cut it out.
Hashtag Jeremy, edit that part out. Next on my little list here is DJ
now we
Russ.
Should have sensitive mood music playing as we get to our serious point.
Yes. BJ Raji, Chris, I'm going to think of a comeback while you talk about BJ Raji.
I really want to see him back. They need him next year, as far as I can tell. You could tell when he was not in the game, when he was injured, they didn't play as well as the defense, and I would overpay BJ Raji for next year. Beyond that, I don't want to make a long-term commitment. He is getting a little bit older, but that's one place where I would kind of overspend. I think he's, and I think they will bring him back because I think they loved what he did last year.
I defended BJ Raji more times than I could care to remember on Twitter and other places and in real life as well, because people don't see him making, you know, sacking the quarterback or making huge plays in the backfield, and they think, well, he's just a fat guy. And that's all he is. He's Gilbert Brown without the talent, and all he does is take up space. But it's just not true. You watch the film, and the guy, he does things to open up lanes for other guys, and he's very valuable when he's healthy. And he stayed healthy for the majority of this year, unfortunately. The only unhealthy part of this year was right when we needed him the most. But I would absolutely – I don't know how much I'd overpay for him. I wouldn't break the bank for the guy, but – if we can get him back on another kind of prove yourself deal like we did last year, absolutely. I want him back.
Fair enough. By the way, Chris, just for my argument about Avril Lavigne, those are Canadian references, so they don't count as much as American TV show references.
Well, yeah, you could say that, but what's his name on Full House? Also a Canadian.
True.
Dave Coulier, Canadian.
Yep.
Yeah, but he doesn't count.
He most certainly counts.
I'm pretty sure he's a robot.
Anyway, could a robot be that funny? I think not.
I don't think you know what that word means. Anyway. James, Mason Crosby, your thoughts?
Bring him back. He's got to come back. He has to. That's my opinion. That's my Mason Crosby hot take. The guy, I said awful, awful, awful things about Mason Crosby in 2012 that I regret forever. I feel so bad about him. And I'm going to go to confession over Lent several times, and I'm just going to repent for everything I said about Mason Crosby, because he has proven me wrong, and he's played so well the last couple of years. He's about as automatic as it gets these days. He's got to come back.
So, James, you said some awful things. You said some terrible things about him. I wrote them down and published them on the site. So But I was wrong, and I can't believe he snapped back the way he did. But yeah, man, he is so money, especially, and this sounds silly, especially with extra points the way they are now. We need Mason Crosby back. And look how many teams struggled to find a serviceable kicker. You don't want to be in that situation. Although, I do hear Giorgio Tavecchio is free.
Free in cost or free as in available?
Well, a little bit of both.
Interesting. You would know if anybody would.
we are basically besties.
Pretty much. I got invited to that pajama party. I'm sorry I couldn't make it. Last one on my list here is, of course, we're saving best for last really here, Brett Good. The long snapper. Oh, Chris, I'm sorry. It's your turn.
I could tell you I'm going to be really clever here. Get ready, guys. Get ready for this.
Oh, crap. All right.
He's good as gone. Long snappers are easily replaceable. He's older with a knee, with a knee that was blown out, and his replacement, who was slinging hoagies the week before, did a nice job. As far as I know, I didn't watch a whole lot of long snapper tape, so I just don't see how he's back next year.
I physically cannot speak words because of that joke. My mind has been blown out of my ear holes. It's all over the wall.
I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. I'm used to it. He's gone.
Yeah.
All right. I'll mention this real quickly just to put a bow on this segment. Brett Good, place of birth, Canadian, Texas. I'm not sure what part of Canada that is, but
that's confusing.
That is really, yeah, that's like, it's a part of Texas where they just wear a lot of denim and are very polite.
And warm, apparently. I just happened to look that up, and it's Canadian, Texas. All right. Makes sense.
Is that a portion of Texas that Canada annexed? We should look into that.
Ooh, that'd be interesting. I would consider moving there. Anyways, we are almost at the end of the show. It's time to discuss our last question of the show, which is basically based on something that James tweeted out earlier today. I wonder what Jeff Janis is doing right now. And so, James, I'm going to throw it to you first. What do you think Jeff Janis is doing right now?
I think Jeff Janis right now is bringing Aaron Rodgers some lemonade or whatever it is Aaron Rodgers drinks. I don't know. Superhero juice. he's fanning him with big, large fans, and he's feeding grapes into his mouth. He is doing everything he can to make sure that Aaron Rodgers is a happy quarterback so that next year he might be able to have a ball thrown at him that's less than 60 yards. Or he's getting wasted on Coors Light at a frat house somewhere. One of the two.
I mean, obviously, I think we all know what Jeff Janis is doing right now. He's turning water into wine.
Mm-hmm. Oh. True. I personally, I guess in my mind's eye, I imagine him resting in the Fortress of Solitude, watching Golden Girls reruns in his underwear.
That's a picture.
Yes. Well, never mind that that's what I'll be doing after the podcast. But on that note, that's a heck of a way to end a podcast, isn't it? To discuss
it is.
Watching Golden Girls.
Only fitting way, I think.
Yeah, it's truly the only way to go out. On that note, we all have Twitter handles. By all means, if you want to follow us on Twitter or block us on Twitter after listening to this show. James, what's your Twitter handle once again?
I am at JKSub20, JKSUB20.
Chris, your Twitter is?
At TTSO_Chris.
And I am at That's Our Bobo, TATSOURBOBBO, 3 Bs, 2 Os, because there's only one Bobo. And having said that and made everybody cringe because that's just a terrible saying, I do want to remind everyone to pet their cat, because that's my job around here. James, do you have any last words?
Just that I want to say that if Jeff Janis is truly drinking beer at a frat house right now, I would like for him to bring me some, because I just had to picture him in his underwear watching Golden Girls.
Nobody forced that on you. Well,
wait a minute. Hang on. I can't bring up Full House and you can bring up underwear Golden Girls? Come on now.
Chris is going to defend me on Golden Girls.
I will. I'm a big fan.
Yes. Chris, any final words?
Good night, Prince Janis.
Yes, indeed. And on that note, we will end the podcast. And Chris, you've got the button, I believe, so.
I do. If I never press it, does that mean the podcast just continues forever?
I guess so.
All right,
in
well,
which case, I feel like we should be doing a telethon instead.
Yeah, that would be a really good idea. All right, good night, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name. And they're always glad you came. You want to be where you can see. Our troubles are all the same. You want to be where everybody knows your name.
Are you looking for some signed Packer memorabilia?
Look no further than Waukesha Sports Cards.
If a Green Bay Packer can sign it, Waukesha Sports Cards has it.
Check our website for upcoming Packer player and legend signings.
Go to WaukeshaSportsCards.com.
Eddie Lacy, Mike Daniels, Gilbert Brown, Don Barclay, Micah Hyde, your Green Bay Packers, yesterday's legends and today's superstars. From corporate or nonprofit events to private parties, add some spice, hire a Packers player from Mayfield Sports Marketing. For details, just go to PackersTalk.com and click on Player Appearances.